There they are. Wave hi to people. Wave hi. Yeah. Yeah. Wave hi.
I forgot to write this down.
Okay.
I will write that down.
Hi guys.
Yep. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Hi, Nina. Well, I'm glad you made it. You're in the right place. No, that's what it was. Now I'm triggering my memory because I've talked to him numerous times.
Right. Okay. So it was canceled that day.
All right, praise God. Welcome, welcome. All right. Glad everybody's here this morning. I know the roads are like a ice skating rink out there, but we're glad you're here and watching online, everybody. So last week we had more hymns. This time we got more contemporary or newer stuff. But we're going to start with one hymn, How Great Thou Art. This one never gets old. You never get tired of singing this song. And How Great Thou Art. I guess this will be dependent on how Hadassah does for us here. Come here. She wants to help mommy play piano. Let's sing it right out. 147. Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down in grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, And when I think that God his son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come, oh, he's coming, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Let's do the other version. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will sing how great is our God. Isn't that beautiful? That's for Shannon there. Praise God. She likes that one. All right. Peace, praise. Let's do the name of the Lord is a strong tower. We'll skip the, that's why we praise him. We'll do that in our time. Let's do the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it. Aren't you thankful you can run into Jesus today? The name of that the Lord is a strong, strong tower. Page 30. Blessed be the name of the Lord, O Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, O Most High. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into, they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into, and they are saved. Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord. Glory to the name of the Lord. O Most High. The Lord is a strong tower, the righteous run on in to and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, sky. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, sky. You know how we bless the Lord is by praising him, talking good about him. He's cursed and damned in this world every day. And how much for us when we get to praise his name, to say how good he is, how wonderful, and that is how we bless him. And it's in Christ alone my hope is found. It's page 16. Again, this is maybe not a hymn, but look at the words. It's written like a hymn. It's got some powerful lyrics here. And sing it as if you're really just first time you heard this and really mean it with all your heart.
Christ alone my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the world he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ, I stand. On me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
I don't know about you, but when those words, no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from your hand. Oh, that's powerful words. Aren't you thankful? Thank you, Jesus. All right, let's just do one or two here. Let's do 700 in the hymnal. Let's finish off with that for right now. 700. You are my hiding place. It's a little chorus here in the hymnal. If you got something going on today, and you can run away to hide in Jesus. Can't hide from your problems because you still got to deal with them, but you can hide in His protection and in His peace. And He's got you. Songs of deliverance. If you need something today to sing about, there's songs of deliverance.
Songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in You. I will trust in You. Let the weak say I am strong in the strength of the Lord. You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs of deliverance. Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in You.
I'll sing it to Him.
I will trust in You. Let the weak say I am strong in the strength of the Lord. You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with songs.
Oh, thank You, Jesus. Songs of deliverance.
Whenever I am afraid, I will trust in You. I will trust in You. Let the weak say I am strong in the strength of the Lord.
Thank You, Jesus. We thank You, Lord God, that we can run to You and we are saved from all our enemies. You deliver us. You protect us. You preserve us. You sustain us. You're so faithful. And we have magnified Your name. We say You are good. Your mercy endures forever. You're the God of the impossible. There's never a situation that you're not going to have an answer for or a way out. You make a way out. And we just rejoice in You today that You have comfort for us. You have peace for us as we trust You, as we follow You, as we obey. We lay aside and lay down our own opinions, our own thoughts, and our own, we cast down vain imaginations and every lofty thought that exalts itself against You. And we submit ourselves to the obedience of You, Jesus Christ. You are Lord. You're our Lord. And we're so thankful. You're a great, great God in heaven and a great Father. And we love You, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, thank You that You make Jesus so real to us. We welcome You here. Let Your love be just surrounding Your people here, that they would sense Your presence and know that You've got them today. You will not let us fall. You do not sleep nor slumber, and You watch over us. You're our keeper. We rejoice, Lord, before You. Songs of deliverance. You are and will and forever will be our Savior, healer, deliverer, our righteousness. We trust You today. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen. Good singing. Praise God. Good music. Thank you, everybody. All right. Let's jump into it here. Got some announcements and stuff. A couple of praise reports. Dave Sleeman is feeling much, much better, and he's wanting to get out and about. So I think it's going to be soon. So he's just trying to take his time so he doesn't rush it. But he's doing well. And Gene is all feeling well. He didn't get anything real bad, just kind of wasn't feeling good a day or two. But it's really Alex who's battling the cold. So let's pray for Alex to get stronger and beat this cold. It's just the winter stuff going on, you know. And so God's bringing health and healing. Also, you can remember Matt Reed. He has his court case this week. So I'm not sure exactly what day yet. I got to find out, but it is this week, and he finds out whether probation or some time. So let's be praying, and then obviously Amanda and the kids. Okay, so somebody in the church this past week said they got a bunch of people around somewhere in their neighborhood and donated a ton of food to Amanda and the kids. I mean, just a huge. We had the whole table full, and she came and picked it up and talked. And so thank you for blessing her and the family. So let's just continue to remember them. And they're watching online today, so we love you guys. Faye's granddaughter Ella had a concussion playing, was it volleyball? Basketball. So let's be praying for Ella and that she'll get all healed up in the noggin, because that's a very important thing. All right, Vicky's birthday is this week, so make sure you tell her how young she is and love on her, okay? And then Chloe Hirsch, she's still in Utah, but that's her birthday as well. All right, Sunday night house of prayer tonight at 6, clean team tomorrow at 10, and Wednesday Bible study at 6:30. And I wanted to say about Sunday night prayer, we've done it for 1 year now, and we have seen God just bless from that. And so if you really want a good time, Sunday nights, we just play music, and we just sit and pray and read our Bible, whatever. It's a really powerful time, and it's a good. And we'll also be live streaming it. There is a new address for Alexis Hurst, so there's that if you want to send her a message. Leanna is very homesick. Leanna wants to get back home, but I don't know how long they're going to be out there, so just be praying for that family as well. Vision Sunday is next Sunday. Oh, this is exciting. Yeah, we like Vision Sunday. So make sure you get your form there. We work on three things. This is for you as a family and your family, and then obviously we as a church. This is for kids too. So all kids, the kids will each have their vision list that they can do. But we work on three things. What do we want to give into the kingdom of God? What we want to be, believe in the Lord, be able to give more, be able to do more, things like that. Our debts and obligations, that we get out of debt and say, Lord, help me get out of debt. Here's my bills, that type of thing. And then third thing, what's on our, we don't call it a bucket list. It's a vision list of what we're releasing faith the Lord to help us to accomplish or things we want to do. Could be taking a trip, could be remodeling a house, buying a house. It doesn't matter, buy a car. But things you're saying, Lord, help me make this possible because I can't do it. And you just put it in there and before the Lord, and he does things. So we'll do that. And obviously, it's also kind of like the annual church meeting where I share all the things that went on with the church this past year and where we're going next year. So it'll be a good time. All right. Game night. We're going to have another game night Friday, January 28th at 6 p.m. So make sure you come on out for that. We have a lot of fun. Just bring some snacks. And Dave Sleeman, hopefully he's back because he beats everybody at cards, and somebody should put him in his place and beat him. So I told him, you better watch out for game night. So he's excited for that. And then we want to do a ladies' craft night. There's Donna was talking about it with Ann, and so please, after church, see them two ladies. They'll meet together, I guess, somewhere, and you can figure out a day and a time to do a ladies' craft night. Sound good? Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's cross-stitching, crocheting. I don't know any what you're doing, but I know it'll be fun, okay? And if you're a guy that wants to do it, I'm sure they'll let you in if you know how to do it. I'll stay away from it, but you want to let guys in?
No, historically, there are more men knitters than there are female.
There you go. All right, guys. Join the challenge. Okay.
I don't think.
Yeah.
That's right, I do.
Hey, praise God. Yeah, is it growing back?
Well, I can't see it yet.
Okay, all right.
But it's formed.
There, praise God. Praise God. All right. I think that's all the announcements, right? That's everything? We're glad you guys came. I know it's bad roads out there, and I know there's a lot of people watching online because of bad roads, but thanks for coming and watching online. What a blessing. All right, let's take up tithes and offerings this morning. If you're, there's no pressure to give, remember, there's no pressure here. There's no charge to be here. And where's Naomi? Come get your... But I wanted to read you Deuteronomy 28. Not the whole thing. It's a long chapter. But first couple verses... Okay, as we do our tithes and offerings. The reason I read a verse or something before tithes and offerings is because, A, we do this in faith, and it's an act of worship. Giving is an act of worship. And so this is just as much important as the sermon. And so, because we want to be givers and give to the Lord. But a lot of people think Deuteronomy 28 is the law, and it's only the law, and it's Old Testament, and doesn't apply for today. But the truth still remains that if you obey God, he takes care of you. Doers get blessed. If you obey God's word, there's life in it and there's blessing. And we have no, you know, you think of Psalms, what it was, it says, surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life, you know? Surely goodness and mercy. This is Deuteronomy 28, and it says the blessings would overtake us. I get the impression that God wants to chase us down to say, hey, I got a blessing for you. He chases us down to get us blessed. But Deuteronomy 28 says, now it shall be if you diligently obey the Lord your God, being careful to do all his commandments, which I command you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the earth, and all these blessings will come upon you and overtake you if you obey the Lord your God. Now again, we know as we have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and we have not obeyed, but Jesus did come, and he did obey, and he bought us, for us, the blessing. He restored the blessing to us. So it's not by works now, it's by faith, but we still obey the word of God. And so it says, all these blessings will come upon you and overtake you. And then skip down to verse 8. Okay, verse 8, it says, the Lord will command the blessing upon you and your barns and in all that you put your hand to, and he will bless you in the land which the Lord your God gives you. The Lord will establish you as a holy people to himself, as he swore to you, if you keep the commandments of the Lord your God and walk in his ways. So all the people of the earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they will be afraid of you. The Lord will make you abound in prosperity, and the offspring of your body, and the offspring of your beast, and the produce of your ground, and the land which the Lord swore to your fathers to give you. The Lord will open up for you his good storehouse, the heavens, to give rain to your land in its season, and bless all the work of your hand. And you shall lend to many nations, but you shall not borrow. The Lord will make you the head, not the tail, and you only will be above, and you will not be underneath, if you listen to the commandments of the Lord your God, which I charge you today, to observe them carefully. And do not turn aside from them, and the words which I command you today, to the right or to the left, to go after other gods and serve them. So aren't you thankful God has commanded the blessing for us? The blessings for us. The devil's people shouldn't be the ones that are blessed. They lie, they steal, they cheat, and that's how they get their money. For you and I, how do we get our stuff? It's the blessing of the Lord. He multiplies what we have. The 5 loaves, 2 fish, he multiplies it. He provides our needs. And we look to him as our source. And so I'm so thankful that this is still the word of God, and it's still for today. Because we're doers, aren't we? We give, we bless the Lord. And so let's release faith this morning. Lord, we take your word at face value. We're not going to explain it away. We're not going to be guilty of it because it's your blessing on our life and you're increasing us and doing good things. We just give you the glory for all that you're doing in our life. We're continually coming up higher. We're able to do more, be a bigger blessing. We have more than enough. We're just thankful, Lord, for how you're providing for us. And we don't look to the government. We're thankful for maybe government doing stuff and all that, but you're our source. Our job is wonderful, but you're our source. Nothing takes your place. You are our source. We think that there's no fixed income. Nobody in this room is on a fixed income because you are the Father in heaven, and you have many ways to get your people blessings. So, Lord, we just release faith, and we thank you for your goodness in our life. We give you our pocketbooks. We say we trust you with our finances, and we will give you our first and our best, what is owed to you is our heart of worship, in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. All right, have fun giving. And Gene is going to come up here and sing a special song for us today. Come on up. Okay. Praise God. Oh, and the littles over there have some. They got. Yep, there you go. Just make sure the camera can get you in.
Before I get into the song, I got something I want to say. Even when I was leading worship at the other church, I never did the songs. This is going to be my first time doing this in front of a congregation. It is a little difficult song in some parts for my voice, but we'll get through it. The Holy Spirit will get us through it. When Noah was talking about praising this morning, I was like, man, the Holy Spirit just works in wonderful ways, because I have some scriptures here. It's about praise. Psalms 132:9 says, let my priests be clothed in righteousness. Let my saints sing praises for joy. And then Psalms 89:15, blessed are the people who know the joyful sound. They walk in the light of your countenance, O Lord. And what that means is that when we actively go into worship, we're walking in God's light. We're receiving the gifts of the Holy Spirit if we open ourselves up. And I hadn't planned on saying this, but I was thinking it back there, and I know the Holy Spirit has to be telling me to say this. But there, I saw a video one time on YouTube, and it was about a pastor that was talking about the whole universe, how the whole universe praises God in its own way. And I don't know if you guys have ever seen this video or not, but if Noah would like some time, I'll find it and we can share it with you guys. But they took a microphone, a large microphone, and they've recorded sounds in outer space, way out there. I mean, huh?
Lulegiggulum.
Yeah. I've seen that one. Cool. Then you know what I'm talking about.
He gets excited.
So they recorded the sounds of stars and nebulas out in space. They actually emit sounds. Mm-hmm. And then he took the sounds that whales in the ocean make, the singing of whales, and they mixed those sounds together. And I'm not kidding you, but then they started playing Chris Tomlin's How Great Is Our God, and the sounds that the stars and the whales made provided the music for that song.
Yep.
It was awesome. The stars are singing out praises to God all the time. The whales are singing praises to God. So, I mean, it fits so perfect and it's so beautiful. And there is a song I want to do sometime. It's called So Will I 100 Billion Times, if you've ever heard that song. And it talks about how the stars, in God's breath, he created 100 billion galaxies, and how the stars worship him. And that video would go really good if Noah allows me to do that song sometime. I'd like to play that video before that. But we were created to praise God. That's what we were created for. Psalms 156 says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. With that said, we'll go into the song. But if you know the song, please sing along. And if you don't, just actively worship God and let him know you love him. Just up a little bit, please.
Absolutely.
One day holds weight above them all. His fame outlasts the earthy form. His praise resounds beyond the stars and echoes in our hearts. The greatest one of all. His face shines brighter than the sun. His grace as boundless as his love. He reigns with healing in his wings, the King above all kings, the greatest one of all. Lift up our eyes, see the King has come. Light of the world reaching out for us. There is no other name, there is no other name. Jesus Christ our God. Seated on high, the undefeated one. Mountains bow down as we lift him up. There is no other name, there is no other name. Jesus Christ our God. Find hope when dolls. Behold the triumph of the cross. His power has trampled death and grave. Our life found in His name. The greatest name of all. Lift up our eyes, see the King has come. Light of the world reaching out for us. There is no other name. There is no other name. Jesus Christ our God, seated on high, the undefeated one. Mountains bow down as we lift Him up. There is no other name, there is no other name. Jesus Christ our God. Now's the time to let Him know. Just raise your hands and thank Him for all He's done in your life. Because He is the name above all names. Hallelujah. Let all the earth tremble and shake. The earth will shake and tremble before Him. Chains will break as heaven and earth sing. Holy is the name, holy is the name of Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. The earth will shake and tremble before Him. Chains will break as heaven and earth. Holy is the name, holy is the name of Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Lift up our eyes, see the King has come. Light of the world reaching out for us. There is no other name, there is no other name. Jesus Christ our God, seated on high, the undefeated one. Mountains bow down as we lift Him up. There is no other name, there is no other name, there is no other name. There is no other name, Jesus. Let Your presence rain down upon us. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
I think it turned back on. There it goes.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Praise God. If you don't know Jesus Christ, today's the day to know Him. Today's the day. You're watching online. If you don't know Jesus, He's the one who died on the cross for our sins. He offers eternal life. It's a free gift. Can't work for it. Can't earn it. Can't do anything. You have to admit you're a sinner. You have to repent. True repentance. Say, God, I've sinned against You, and I am so sorry, and I want You to come live within me, fill me with Your Spirit, and something supernatural will happen. You'll be born again. Many people think they're going to say a prayer and just get to heaven. It's actually the Spirit's work. You must be born again. Many people just say a prayer and then they go live for the devil the rest of their life like they never said anything. No. You really mean it with all your heart. The Holy Spirit comes in and you have a new heart, a new spirit. You're born from above, the Bible says. And if you aren't born again, today's the day. It's so simple. And you repent of your sin and you realize Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. He died for you and I. He offers that salvation. Praise God. It's fun sitting up here with Moses while you're singing. He says, he's got a beard. He saw that you grew your beard out. The things that kids notice. I love it. The things they notice. Praise God. Let's do it. I give you a whole list of songs. I know we never get through them, but we just see how it goes and how many we can get in. But let's at least do the song that we have as an insert on your bulletin. Okay, it's a new one. It's a little chorus called Lamb of Glory. Okay. Again, we don't mind trying new stuff here. We'll try this, and it's a powerful little song. Love's most wondrous story, heart of God's redemption plan, or redemption of man. How are we gonna do this? Hey, Dassie, you want me to hold you? Come here. Oh, it's okay. Go ahead and stand up. God's word that kings and priests and prophets heard, there would be a sacrifice and blood would flow to pay sin's price. Precious Lamb of glory, love's most wondrous story, heart of God's redemption of man, worship the Lamb of glory. On the cross, God loved the world while all the powers of hell were hurled. No one there could understand. The one they saw was Christ the Lamb, precious Lamb of glory, love's most wondrous story. The Lamb of glory, precious Lamb of glory, love's most wondrous story, heart of God's redemption of man, worship the Lamb of glory. You know, isn't this amazing? Because the angels can't sing this. They don't know the redemption. Only you and I, as human beings, know the redemption. And that just boggles my mind, that we have a song that the angels can't sing. They don't know that firsthand account of being redeemed from sin. But it's a wondrous story. We've heard that from God's word. The kings, priests, and prophets have heard. There would be a sacrifice. I'm so thankful, aren't you? The Lamb of Glory. Redemption, bought back. We were under the power of Satan, and Jesus died and bought us back from the slavery. We were slaves of sin. So we've been redeemed back. All right, maybe just do, let's see. Peace, praise. Number one, all heaven declares. All heaven declares. We'll do one or two more. And I don't know, Michaela, if you already had a bulletin, but I just sent them back there to give you one because I know we forgot to give people one that came in later, so sorry about that. So if you already had one, just smack him when he comes back to you. If you already have it, just say, anyway.
Declares the glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare with the beauty of the Lord? Forever he will be the Lamb upon the throne. Gladly bow my knee and worship Christ alone. I will proclaim Jesus, the glory of the risen Lord, who once was slain reconcile man. Forever you will be the Lamb upon the throne. Bow my knee and worship you alone. All heaven declares
can compare.
Forever you will be, forever you will be the Lamb upon the throne. Gladly bow my knee and worship you,
Jesus. Lord. Let's just listen to his voice right now. To the Lamb who sits upon the throne, be all glory and praise and honor. This Son of God, Son of Man, the Lamb has overcome, defeated death, redeemed mankind, reconciled us back to God. It says now we're friends with God. We were enemies, and now we've been made friends by the righteousness of Jesus Christ, by the sacrifice. Jesus, we thank you for what you did for us on that cross. We'll do thank you for the cross. It's the next one on the list. We'll do that one because it's all about the cross. You know, you never can get away from the cross. Jesus, when Peter said, Lord, forbid that, it won't happen to you, and he says, get behind me, Satan. Anything withholding the cross is not true salvation. You have to have the cross. You have to have the blood. And you and I now pick up our cross and follow daily. It's death to self. It's death to our own ways and saying he is the Lord and Savior. Thank you for the cross. 29.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing. For this love, Lord. Thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated victorious, high and lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the darling of heaven, crucified. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Christ, the Son of God, the Messiah. Thank you for that you would love us. We have nothing to offer you. It's not like we have nothing to give you but ourselves, and that's all you want. Thank you for such love. While we were yet helpless, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The just for the unjust. Thank you for such love. How you would love us. Oh, just, we're overwhelmed with your love for you, for us. Why? How can you? How can you? It's incredible. What is man that you're mindful of us? You made the stars and you made all these different things that echo and bless your name and praise you. And here, what is man that we've cursed you? We've condemned you. We've done these things and yet you loved us and you never gave up on us and you offered us mercy. Lord, thank you for your mercy here right now. Whatever thing we need to deal with in our life, the sin that's there, it can be forgiven right now. We confess before you. We repent and we receive the gospel. We receive that free gift of grace. Thank you, Lord, for what you did for us. Lord, open our eyes, because without you, we will not see. Open our ears and our hearts. Give us understanding and discernment, that we might know what's freely given us by the Holy Spirit. Let's finish with, there's something about that name. There's something about that name. Thank you, Jesus. 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 There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Before we sing it last time, I want you to think, when you say that name, demons have to flee. The strongholds, the oppression that is on you has to lift off you and let go off of you. And so whatever you're carrying right now, in the name of Jesus, we come against that burden and we say, be removed in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. All the forces of hell that are raging against it and causing problems for the people of God, we say, The forces of hell must cease and desist in their maneuvers. Now, in Jesus' name, the attacks from the enemy must be stopped. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. We have victory in Jesus. So we come against this darkness. We come against this oppression in the name of Jesus. Depression, leave the people of God now. Freedom come in Jesus' name. Oppression could be in the body too. You feel, you know, just aches and pains and not feeling well. There is hope and there's healing right now in Jesus' name. Healing is in this house because Jesus is here. Be made whole. Be made whole right now. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus. There's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, fragrance after the rain. Oh, Jesus is here. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms shall all pass away, but there's something about that name. Praise God. Lord, do what you want to do in this place. Do whatever you want. Bring life, bring healing and freedom. It's your service. We give it over to you, Holy Spirit. Be glorified. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Isn't the Lord good? Anybody want to share a quick testimony?
Well, I just wanted to say something. I saw him led to this morning. Noah asked me if I was going to do a special, and I said, "What are you going to do? You have something in mind?" And he said, "No, whatever the Lord speaks to you." And I said, "Okay." And as I said, I've never done that song before, but it was about Jesus, the name above all names.
Amen.
And it seems like everything we've been talking about so far this morning is Jesus. And I sent Noah back a message, and I said, "This is the song I'm going to do. This is what God is speaking to me with this song. I've never done that song before." But that's just now the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
He gave me that song to sing, and it goes right along with what the pastor was talking about. That's just how the Holy Spirit works. If you just open up and listen, the Holy Spirit will open a whole new world to you.
Amen.
He'll tune you up and tune you in.
I like that. I like that. That's good. That's good. Praise God. Any other testimonies before we get in the Word today? God is good. He's doing good things, isn't he? Doing real good things. All right. Well, let the kids be dismissed. Elijah and Naomi, can you hand these out for me first, please? I got a little sermon notes here. We're working on talking about the Holy Spirit, and so I've got some things here. Just pass out, make sure everybody's got one. Okay, we're going to start. So some of this is what we talked about last week, and then I don't think we're going to get hardly as very far today, as far as I want to get, but that's all right. The Lord's got other things, and so it's good. But this is something we've been working on about the gifts of the Spirit, okay? We talked about Christmas time. We all have gifts, I'm assuming, and we all receive gifts. The Holy Spirit gives gifts, okay? The Holy Spirit has given to you and I different things. And so last week we talked about it, and you see from the notes there that we talked about how there's prophecy, there's serving, teaching, exhorting, giving, leading, and showing mercy. And we looked at how he said even how to do those things. Do it with generously, do it with diligence, how to serve. And then he said, like a bullet points, be devoted to one another in brotherly love, honor people, be of the same mind, associate with lowly, don't be haughty in mind, love without hypocrisy. He gave us all these different things. Thank you, I appreciate it. And so we looked at that last week, okay? We're going to kind of build off of that. And so last week I went home and I realized I'd offended a whole bunch of people. I mentioned truckers, and I made it sound like bad, and I didn't mean it bad as a bad thing. What the story I was alluding to was a ministry that deals with truckers, and they get these truck drivers, and they say, I stink, I haven't taken a bath, I don't want you to hug me. And the people said, we don't care, we just want to hug you. And they loved on these truckers. So I wasn't trying to offend any truckers out there. We love the truckers. I'm just saying there is a ministry for every kind of people, and sometimes people don't feel worthy to come into church, or they don't feel good enough, and you realize they realize Jesus meets them where they're at. Doesn't matter what they look like, how they dress. Churches that get into how you dress, that's you want to just let people come and let God work in their heart. It's not about dress. He looks at the heart. Man looks at the outward appearance. God looks at the heart. Not to say we can't dress up, but I'm just saying the point is, it's not some elite class. All are welcome, and Jesus takes us in. And so that's what it's about, okay? So I wasn't trying to offend anybody, but we talked about people that had ministry, that could do ministry to all different kinds of different things. And so I don't know if we'll get there today, but that would be in 1 Corinthians 12, which one day we'll get there, okay, about the gifts and ministries and effects, and they're different. But today we're going to start off in Matthew chapter 6 and Acts 1, okay? Every time I keep trying to get ahead, the Lord says, step back. keep laying a foundation, which I love. He keeps showing us other things. Matthew 6. Now, again, this is a very small verse, so you don't have to turn there if you don't want to, but I'm going to read it here to get where we want to go. We love the Word of God here, so if you need a Bible, there's one back there, but we love God's Word. This is what we study. Again, this is, should be like a Bible education. We believe church should be like Bible college. You come and you get a good education so you can go out there in the world and be able to share what you know. So that's why we get into the Word. There are some churches you don't have to open your Bible at all. We encourage you to open your Bible. This is where you want to be. Okay, Matthew 6, verse 6. Okay. It says, but you, when you pray, go into your inner room, close your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Okay? So we have, this is the first room we're going to look at, is an inner room. What we do in our own personal prayer time determines our spiritual life. Sunday church won't make our spiritual life. That's part of it. That's part of it. But it's the daily relationship with Jesus. That inner room, we call it the prayer closet, right? We talk about, it's where you get quiet with the Lord and you have your devotions every day. And you say, Lord, talk to me. I want to talk to you. Here's what I got. That is birth from prayer. When you want to have a heart of prayer and you realize it's not about praying in front of people, which is good, you can do that, but it's about when nobody's around that you're seeking the Father, that you're talking with the Father, okay? And he's drawn to that. He says, if you pray in secret, your Father who is in secret will see what's done in secret and reward you. So first off, you have the inner room. That should be all of us at our own homes. We're ministering to the Lord, singing while we're in the shower, right? And we're praising the Lord, okay? That's the first room. Each of us need that and want that in the quietness of our heart. The second one, though, we find at Pentecost in Acts, okay? So I want to go to the second part. It's in Acts chapter 1, okay? So Matthew 6 talked about the inner room. Now we have the upper room. The first one was personal, just individual, okay? We're praising the Lord for ourselves. The second one is where we corporately gather. That's why you come to church, because there's an anointing in corporate worship. There's something about joining voices into one heart. We looked at this last week. We have the same mind toward one another, that type of thing. But Acts, we know the story of how Pentecost happened. The Holy Spirit came, and he is here. He is here. It says in Acts chapter 1, verse 12. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went up to the upper room where they were staying, that is Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon the Zealot, Judas, the son of James. These all with one mind were continually devoting themselves to prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. And then you skip down to chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting, and there appeared to them tongues as of fire distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. So you see a couple things here. They were all together focused on what? Prayer. Everything God does is birthed from prayer. If we want God to move in our life, we need to pray in the inner room, and then we can pray in the upper room. We need both. You don't want just the upper room prayer. You want the inner room prayer. Because in that is where you hear from the Lord, and you're able to join together with one voice. But they were in this upper room, and this is before the Holy Spirit come. But what drew the Holy Spirit? What made that promise happen? Is through the prayer. They were praying. They were of one mind. Verse 14, Acts 1:14. They were of one mind. They were devoting themselves to prayer. Okay? There's this mission. They realized they have this single focus vision and mission. What are we going to do? This gospel's got to go out. Jesus talked about this, and how are we going to do it? We don't know how to do this. You know, they're almost so scared, right, in the upper room. What are we going to do? And this type of thing. And they just were praying and saying, Lord, help us. And then the Holy Spirit came and gave them power to be a witness. Okay? So you see two things here. Inner room, upper room, both were about prayer. Okay? The unity of prayer, or the body of Christ joined together. Now, where we're going to probably camp out and just camp out is in Ephesians. Well, I shouldn't say camp out because the Lord's got other plans, but there's a couple other verses I do need to share. But Ephesians chapter 4, he gives a bunch, and I have this in your notes now. He gives a bunch of things. We call it the fivefold gifts of ministry. And many times we read it and say, well, that's not me, so I'm checked out. And we just check out of it because we think it's not us. But really, we need to realize these are gifts to the body of Christ, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. But really, those are not the main focus. We make that the focus. You realize the focus is the very next verse, which says they're to equip all of us to go out and do the mission. All of us, he said, go into the world and preach the gospel. All of us have the same mandate, the same mission, to get the name of Jesus out there. So in Ephesians chapter 4, but you'll see before we even get to that, you'll see where we're talking about some other things here. Ephesians chapter 4, okay? And I'm trying to slow it down here. Okay. Ephesians 4, verse 1. It says, therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness and patience, or with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. We're talking the gifts of God here. Verse 8, therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. Now this expression, he ascended, what does it mean except that he also descended, or ascended, what does it mean except they descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is himself also he who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave some as apostles, and some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. Okay, so let's stop there. So I have this in your notes, but he gives a couple things, and we again focus on the five things of evangelists, pastors, teachers, all these different things. But the goal is, so the body of Christ can be one, okay? We're to be one, operating together. That's why the upper room was so powerful, because now you had believers coming together, and it was this joining together, and the Holy Spirit came out, and then they were able to be empowered for witnessing and to serve. But I want to back up before we get there to verse 2. Look at verse 2 with the things it says. It gave you five different things. If we're going to walk and be filled with the Spirit, you've got to be, we talked about last week, humility. Humility is huge. You cannot be walking in the Spirit if you're full of pride. It won't work. You have to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Him. You have to lay down your life. So it's humility. Gentleness. The Spirit of God will never make you harsh. He'll make you, He's so gentle and patient. That's who the Lord is. And so that's who we need to be. Humble, gentle, patient. Then showing tolerance for one another in love. Tolerance and in love. We want to be people that, we don't say sin is okay, we're just loving, so sin's okay. But we speak the truth in love and say sin, you can get a way out of sin, there's a way out. But sometimes we need the body of Christ to help us, don't we? Matt right now, he needs encouragement. Say, you can beat this thing, you know. We need the body of Christ to come together to say, we want peace here, we want love of God here, we want unity. Okay, that's verse 3. It's the unity, that's the upper room. The unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Again, churches will never make it if they're fighting. If there's division and strife, it won't work. Your home won't make it. If you've got fighting in your marriage and your family, it'll be a civil war, a house divided. It won't stand. But when there's unity of the Spirit, we can view things differently even. We can say, okay, I may not believe some of these things. I'm still growing in the Lord, not sure I'm there yet. But as we're still seeking the Lord and seeking His word of prayer, all about prayer, that unity is drawn together in the Spirit. And we're holding tightly that. But it always goes back to truth. What is truth? There is one body of Christ. There is one Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit. There's one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father. That right there, you know, shoots out all these other ideas that, well, there's many ways to God. No, there's not. There's one way. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, the life, the only way to get to God. There is only one Lord. There's only one faith. There's only one. And because of God's grace, he gave us gifts. He gave you and I gifts to do the ministry. But we got to first get down that we're going to be humble, gentle, patient, have love and unity, so we can manifest the gifts of the Spirit. And then you go down to verse 11, and he says, these are gifts to the body of Christ, of evangelists, and all these different things. Wonderful. We're so thankful for those in the body of Christ. But the main focus is verse 12. See, we make it all about people putting them on pedestal. Don't put people on pedestals. Put Jesus on the pedestal. He's the one on the throne. Jesus Christ should be on the risen up. People will fail you. People will let you down. Jesus will not. He will never fail. And so we need to say, Jesus, you're the one. But there are these gifts to the body of Christ. Some people would say, well, they died out. They're no longer apostles and prophets. That was back then. No, God's still doing these same things. Apostle nowadays would be somebody who goes and starts churches. And there's many times they're church planting. And they're over, especially overseas we see it. Not as much here, but overseas especially. And the apostles do different things. And they're able to set all these churches up. And it's really neat. The prophetic is still in operation. You got people that know the times and what we as a nation should do. That's prophetic. Obviously, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. But verse 12, equipping the saints for the work of service. That is the upper room. Okay? So all these saints should be in the inner room praying and devoted to the Lord in prayer. But it's when we get together that we realize that we're building up of the body of Christ so that we can go out there and bring the fullness of Christ to people. Okay? And so it says that very clearly there, that we need to be equipped for the work of service. That comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's the one who equips us for service. Because on our own, we don't know what to say. We don't know what to do. We don't know the answers. A lot of times, we don't even know what we're fighting in the spirit realm. But the Holy Spirit does. And so as we get in our inner room, we pray. As we get with the upper room, as a body of Christ, we can get growing up in the Lord to be full, the mature man, the measure that belongs to Christ. There's the unity of the faith. Okay? Now, this is not in your notes, but I want to go to Colossians chapter 3 because I want you to see it says pretty much the same thing here. It's important that we have the upper room, this. It's important that we are together, one spirit, with a bond of peace, united. We have to have unity, in which we do. I'm just saying, you always want the body of Christ to be going the same direction. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. So Colossians chapter 3. I'm going to bring this home to personal application here in a second. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Okay, Colossians 3, verse 12. So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Sounds exactly what we just read. Bearing with one another and forgiving each other, whoever has a complaint against one another, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ richly dwell within you with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. Whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Doesn't that sound just like what we read in Ephesians? Compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing with one another, and forgiving. So where does this apply now for us? Okay, it means we need to be walking in such love that we don't shame people, we don't guilt them, we forgive, we bless them, because we want to embrace and love on people. It's not about, well, you did this, you did this. It's letting the love of God deal with them. And it says that, where'd it go here? I wonder, look at that. It said, okay, and then beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity.
if unity comes from when people feel safe in the upper room, if they don't feel safe in the upper room where they can come and say, hey, I'm dealing with stuff in my life, I need help. If there's not that security, then they're going to feel like, oh, everybody's more spiritual than me, and I can't measure up, and I'm no good, and the devil isolates them. And the devil will isolate people and say, yeah, you're not good enough, you shouldn't be, what are you doing, you know? They have it all together. They're growing in the Lord. They're spiritual, and all these gifts of spirit, and here you are struggling. Now, let's see, that unity is where they come around each other and say, hey, you're struggling, we're going to pull you up. That's how the Holy Spirit moves. The Holy Spirit doesn't leave people behind. Jesus came to seek and to save those who are lost. He'll go find the one lost sheep that's lost. So in the upper room, it's for when we're corporate joining together to worship the Lord. If somebody's struggling, we're there to encourage. That's why we need the church. That's why we need the power of the Spirit in the church. Because that's the perfect bond of unity. And then the peace of Christ can rule in our hearts because we've been in the inner room. And then we can be thankful as a body. You see that? Verse 15. The peace of Christ rules in us individually. But then it says you were called in one body, be thankful. The body itself, the corporate worship, we're thankful for what the Lord has done and how he's given us peace in our hearts. How his peace is ruling our hearts individually. And then when we join together, everybody's enjoying that. Okay. But then you look at verse 16, okay? You've got psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. The Spirit of God will cause you to have songs of deliverance, a song of praise to the Lord. And you'll find yourself having a song. Again, that doesn't matter if it's another hymnal, whatever song. It could be a new song that you make up on the fly. I've had those too. You know, you just worship the Lord. You're just singing and saying, thank you, Lord, for being so good. And that came from the inner room as you worship him in your personal prayer closet. But then you get together, and that's why it's so powerful when we join together, because we've all come from our inner prayer closet, the inner room. And when we get together, it's just this energy of Jesus. We love Jesus, and it's the Holy Spirit, and the power of God is drawn to that unity, and things happen. Okay, but what happens is, again, people don't feel safe, and I really believe that this, we're a hospital for the brokenhearted, aren't we? We don't have it all together. We can say, I'm struggling with something, I need help, and there's this coming together of such compassion, kindness, not saying, well, you should be more spiritual, you should have this figured out by now. It's saying, okay, what's the word say? Let's get you back on track. What's the word say? There's mercy, there's grace, let's get back on track. It's always compassion, kindness, humility. That's how the Spirit moves. That's how the Holy Spirit operates. And so he'll speak to that through the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, but it's for us to take it personally and to enjoy it. Okay? Now, I think I'm going to close. Well, let's see, I got two here to close with. James chapter 5, I got two more and we'll close with this. To bring it home, though, for us, okay? What does it mean for us? James chapter 5, Hebrews, James chapter 5. I'll give you two more and we're done. James chapter 5, verse 13. If you see these in play, Ephesians and Colossians, what we just read, you're going to see James 5. And again, the Spirit of God is moving. There's healing happening. It says James 5, verse 13. Is anyone among you suffering? Then he must pray. Is anyone cheerful? He is to sing praises. Is anyone among you sick? Then he must call for the elders of the church, and they would pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will restore the one who is sick. And the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sins, they will be forgiven him. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. I guess I'll keep reading that. It's just so good. We'll keep going. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the earth for 3 years and 6 months. Then he prayed again, and the sky poured rain, and the earth produced its fruit. My brethren, if any among you strays from the truth, and one turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his ways will save his soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. That's the church right there, enjoying the presence of the Holy Spirit because they're comforting others. They're bringing healing. Healing happens when we feel safe enough to confess our sins and faults to one another. When we realize somebody's not going to shame or guilt me. I just messed up to doing something or whatever. No, they're going to rally around me and say, the Holy Ghost has got you. He's going to help you. We actually find healing when we confess it, not when we hide it. We don't have to try to play some status. Well, am I spiritual enough, or am I good enough, or I don't have these gifts, so I'm not. No, quit all that. Just receive the grace of God on your life. Receive the power of the Spirit for you. But sometimes he's going to bring others, the church, the upper room, to get together and say, we're going to pray for one another, and we're going to see God move. And that's how healing happens, emotionally, physically, spiritually. We're not to be lone rangers. Yes, we're to have a prayer closet, and the Holy Spirit can use that, absolutely. But we go from the inner room to the upper room. There's both. And that unity, there's a family. We're one body, family. We're safe to share. We're able to keep growing in the Lord together. But that's how we get the healing. When we confess it to one another, say, hey, I'm struggling with this, I need prayer. And then we as a church, we say, the effective prayer of righteous availeth much. And we get to praying. It all goes back to prayer. Going to the Father and saying, Father, somebody's hurting, somebody needs something. We're asking you to pour out your spirit on this need and on this issue. And God does it. That's the beauty of this. The last one is in Matthew 18. Matthew 18, okay? So if you're struggling, this is a safe place. If you're wanting to grow in the Lord, this is a safe place. If you're shouting the victory, that's a good thing. It says, if you praise the Lord, shout the victory. Maybe you don't have bad stuff going on. It's just praise and praise. You know what? Your testimony can bless others and say, God brought me through. Let me shout a song. Let me sing and shout. It's not, you're better than anybody else. You don't have to feel bad for sharing that. You're just saying, God did it for me. He'll do it for you. It's sharing that with everybody, okay? So we can rejoice and shout the victory. It's not just all bad things. You want to share the good things. What God did in your life, you know? Not just sharing the bad stuff. Matthew 18, verse 19. Matthew 18, verse 19. Okay, here it is right here. Matthew 18, 19. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth about anything they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in their midst. When we get in the upper room, corporate body right here, Jesus is here. He's here. The Holy Ghost is here. And if we're worshiping Jesus, he says right here, there's agreement. There's agreement. It's not I'm better than you or you're not good enough. There's agreement. There's unity of the Spirit. And when that happens, he says, I will now answer the prayer. You don't realize God can't answer prayer when there's division and strife. There has to be unity. There has to be the body taking care of one another. This is the promise he gave us for us right here, right now, today, this church, our life. Get with your family, get with your spouse, and come into agreement on the things you're asking for. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth about anything they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. Because what happens is when we come together in unity, we come together in the Word and say, what does the Word say? It's not just asking, you know, it's saying the Word has an answer for it. Let's get together and bring the Word. That's why when you're talking with somebody, don't give them your opinion, give them the Word. Maybe you don't know the right word to say. I've had situations, I don't know what to say to them, but I know there's a word that will comfort them, and I give them Scripture. You know, we don't have to know it all. It's not about being the evangelist, the pastor. I don't know the right Scriptures. Just share a smile, share a hug. That right there, a smile and a hug, and saying a Scripture to them or something, has power. And it will bring healing to people. It brings healing to us, doesn't it? There's agreement. We must be in agreement for the Spirit of God to move. And so that was what the Lord had me share today. Before we even get to 1 Corinthians, I keep trying to get to 1 Corinthians, and 12 and 14, and he just keeps, but it all plays into, again, the gifts of Spirit. Because he gave gifts, but we will never be able to enjoy them if we're walking arrogantly or rudely or being impatient. The gifts of Spirit will not operate then. They can't. It's because the Lord operates through the church. That's why people say, well, I don't need to go to church. I've read the Bible before. I don't need to read my Bible, and I don't need to go to church. I'm all good. No, you need the body of Christ. We need each other. You need to be in the Word. We need it. We're not to be a lone ranger in this. And so the Lord is equipping you today. You're equipped. He's building you up. You're mature. You're growing. You're growing more like Christ, which is gentle and patient. And aren't you thankful you're being more patient and gentle? I confess that over me. I want to be more gentle, more patient, but it comes from agreement. And so we're going to come into agreement right now that whatever you're asking the Lord for, and we're not beggars, we just ask the Father. But that joining together, yes. What do you got?
This actually happened to be in the Bible that I picked up over here.
Okay, yeah.
So it was a devotional, and it was on James 5:13-20.
Cool.
And it's our prayer in God's power. So it says, when we pray for others, we become partners with God in in his works of salvation, healing, comfort, and justice. God can accomplish these things without us, but in his plan, he gives us the privilege of being involved with him through prayer. This assumes that we are praying according to God's will. Prayer is not a magic wand for satisfying our own wishes, but it's an opportunity to work with the Lord in accomplishing his purposes.
Amen. Amen, amen. Amen. You couldn't finish that off any better. Wow. Wow. And these are the promises right here. We can agree on this. If it's in the Bible, we can agree on that. That's so good. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for giving us that word today. We thank you for speaking here. What a blessing. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Lord, give us victory this week like never before. Let your love be around us and to comfort us, encourage us, and speak truth to us. And let's be champions for the faith as we stand firm for you. In Jesus Christ, amen. Let's do an old hymn here. I shall know him. You know this one? I shall know him by the nail prints in his hands. Powerful song. I don't know what number it is, though. I shall know him. I thought that's what it called. Maybe not. It's not called that. I shall know him. I shall know him. I don't know the real title of it. Okay, we'll do a different one then. It's I shall know him, but it's not titled that. It's just the lyric of it. Oh, I sure wrote that. Okay. How about In My Heart There Rings a Melody? Can we do that one?
Yeah,
that's good. Yeah. I wrote down just a couple songs that were in my head, but then I didn't look them up. They were just in my head. In My Heart.
502.
Thank you. All right, appreciate it. There's a melody of love. All right, melody of joy. All right. Song that Jesus gave me. There it is. The Song of Deliverance. Song of Deliverance. 502, let's finish with this. Loud and lively. We'll sing it right out, all right? Raise the roof. Let them hear it through there at their homes. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. It never was a sweeter melody. Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love, which will be my endless theme in glory. With the angels I will sing. It'll be a song with glorious harmony when the chords of heaven ring. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. Praise the Lord. Isn't the Lord good? He's been here today. He's here. Enjoy his blessing. Go out with his blessing on your life. Come back with a testimony, a miracle. Answer the prayer, all right? God bless you. All right. Thanks for watching online, too, everybody. We love you. Make sure to get some of the cookies back there. All right. Give somebody a big hug. Love you. God bless you guys. Thanks for watching.